This is Ham Radio Now, episode 252. Go whoosh when I say that. Episode 252.
Whoosh.
Nice. Well, it's getting more of a whoosh. You know how the thing does.
Mm-hmm.
The thing.
Yeah.
Our first and, I don't know, maybe last, who knows, audio-only edition.
Oh, I thought you were going to say our last trip here.
No. We haven't talked about that yet at all.
Okay.
Our first and maybe last audio-only edition of Ham Radio Now. We're doing the audio-only because it's just the only way I can get something out while we're still doing what we're doing. At the very moment, we are traveling near 200 miles per hour on the EuroStar high-speed train between Paris and London. Oh, by the way, I'm Gary Pierce, KM4AQ, and with me is my lovely wife, Cyndi.
Cyndi Pierce, KD4ACW.
And we are on our European vacation. We have been gone for, what, 10 days?
Weeks.
Almost 2 weeks.
Yeah.
We've got a couple days in London, and then we will head on back to the States. And there's not going to be any ham radio in this episode.
So if you want that, you better turn it off now.
Thanks. Goodbye, audience. No, the reason for doing this is I'm sure that some of you, hopefully many of you, but some of you would like to, you know, hear from me and from Cyndi and a little bit about the trip. And if you're missing the visuals, stop by the Facebook page, the Ham Radio Now Facebook group, and there'll be some pictures there, and you can link mostly to Cyndi's webpage, Facebook page, where she's got a lot of pictures that she's taken from the trip. I've shot a lot of video. I've got like 11 hours of video stacked up on SD cards.
So if you need something to put you to sleep at night, there it is.
Well, you've got no way to see it. It's on my SD cards right now.
Yeah.
In theory, someday I'll have it on YouTube. Maybe I'll edit some of it. Maybe I'll just kind of put it all out there, and you can watch probably when we're done 14 hours of in clips that generally last no longer than 3 or 4 seconds. I mean, I didn't like just let the camera roll. I just I did, you know, short clips of the environment that we were in and the things we were doing. So let's roll back to the beginning. Oh, one more thing. Ham Radio Now is brought to you by you, even this audio edition. We did not bring Arvin on the trip. He's sitting back in the studio. But if you enjoy this, stop by the brand new HamRadioNow.tv website and find Arvin, and you can make a contribution using Patreon for an ongoing subscription. The PayPal is temporarily gone, and it's mostly gone only because I haven't figured out how to integrate the PayPal account into the new website. There's a separate credit card option. It's not PayPal. It's just basically a credit card thing. And you can make individual contributions. People have been using that. Works just fine. So, if you enjoy that. And now, on with the show. My first impression of this trip was the flight over. On an American Airlines 757 that, I'm not sure which of the Wright brothers built that plane.
Yeah, it's going to be mothballed.
Yeah, whether it was Wilbur or Orville personally built the plane, but it was one of those two from that vintage.
Yeah, well, American is starting to get rid of some of its older planes and substituting in Airbuses, but that wasn't one of the flights they did. So,
no.
Yes, it was very archaic. And I was up in first class.
Cyndi was in first class.
And even there, they were giving me this really old clunky tablet, but they gave me Bose acoustic headphones, which was nice, loaded up with a ton of movies, but still, that's just so clunky when you look at all the technology that's out there and other airlines that do it much better. So I'm glad to see they're mothballing their part of their fleet that's very old, but we didn't get the new one on that flight. And won't get the one on returning from London either. It's going to be a 767.
Oh.
Sorry.
Boo.
Yeah.
So you were in first class. Mm-hmm. I was in cattle.
Yep.
Steerage.
You were in good cattle. I got you a seat right behind first class.
Oh, yeah.
Bulkhead.
Yeah.
And you
it
didn't have anything between you and the person
next
to you.
That's true. I got lucky. I had an empty middle row. But no power connections. You had power. I had no power.
Yes. But I found you power courtesy of the wonderful flight attendant that was making sure everything worked right up front.
Yeah, they plugged my phone into the power, sitting in the seat next to where the captain who's sleeping, because it's a long flight, so they have two pilots, two captains. Plugged in there, it went from 30% to 60% in the 7-hour flight.
Yeah, that was sad.
And it was the old audio. This is, I think I took a picture of this and stuck it on the HamRadioNow Facebook group. But the old audio connector, remember the dual prong thing for plugging in headphones? And I had an adapter. I have an adapter sitting home for that. I thought those were obsolete over 10 years ago, so I didn't bring the adapter. So I had my headphones plugged in, and I was listening I watched a movie in glorious mono in my left ear. Cyndi is drinking wine.
Yeah.
They served us lunch and wine.
So this will get more entertaining, especially if they bring me some more.
So they served us lunch and wine on the...
EuroStar.
Yeah, on the EuroStar here.
And we're not even in first class. Yeah. We're in premier coach, I think.
Yep. So you can hear in the background. Again, we're going close to 200 miles an hour. Yeah. Well, you can hear the noise in the background a little bit, but this is what it feels like. It's rocking gently a little bit, bumps a little bit.
And if it ever doesn't rock gently, we're just going to be a spot on the wall. So.
Yeah, so no seat belts or anything.
Yeah, no seat belts. There's no reason for them. Yeah. It just won't matter at the speed.
So we flew to
Amsterdam.
We flew from Raleigh, North Carolina, our home airport, to
Philadelphia.
And there we both flew first class. By the way, we fly first class a lot. Our trips to Hawaii are generally first class. That's because you get a lot of travel points with your business flying, and you know how to work the system.
Yep.
And so you get upgrades. Yeah. Have we ever paid for a first class ticket?
Well, I have not. No, never.
Yeah. And most of the people that are in first class did not buy
first
class ticket. They just are frequent travelers, and they get there through upgrades. Mm-hmm. Now, the upgrade system isn't as cool as it was decades ago.
No, and especially with the merger with U.S. Airways, there's more competition because you've got so many executive platinums floating around out there that take all the seats first before us platinums do.
It occurred to me I wanted to mention I'm recording this on my phone. This is not the Heil mic. It's just the microphone on my
in case you're wondering.
Nexus 6P phone. And I'm using a little app that I found called Lexus Audio Editor. Cool, very classy, high capability audio. Is that your bottle of wine clanking against the glass over there?
That's the glass against that. Okay, we got it.
Yeah, clearing up the sound of the background. It's a cool little audio editor that works on my phone. It does about 80% of the stuff that I do with audio editors professionally. And it cost me $6 as opposed to $300 for Audition or $700 for Pro Tools. So, cool. Cyndi's multitasking. She's looking at her iPad.
I'm not multitasking. I'm just waiting for you to get back to the story. You kind of wander off, you know. You have a tendency to do that.
A hallmark of the program.
It is, I know. Right. And I'm trying to keep you in line and on subject, so let's see how I do.
Yeah, good luck with that.
Yeah.
So we flew to Amsterdam, Philadelphia. That was the long flight. It was a red eye overnight. And we got in...
About 8:30.
And we wandered around...
We didn't wander. We went directly to Kuchenhof.
We are in line to get on the express bus to Kuchenhof, which is the annual tulip festival that runs from April through May.
It's huge. It's internationally known. And
pictures on Cyndi's Facebook page. Cyndi, C-Y-N-D-I, Wood, W-O-O-D, Pierce, P-E-A-R-C-E. Your Facebook page is open to anyone to look at, right?
I think so. Yeah.
You can see the pictures of that. So Kuchenhof.
And we did that, one, because we wanted to go, but two, because we wanted to stay awake.
Yeah.
I've learned in my travels overseas that especially when you come in on a red eye, the best thing to do is just to stay up that day until about the time the sun goes down, if you can, depending on the time of year.
So we began our adventure, at about 2 o'clock in the afternoon?
A little bit.
In Raleigh?
Yes.
Yeah. And ended up in local time, in Amsterdam at 8 a.m., having been up all night, essentially.
Yep.
And that's a 6-hour time difference, 6 hours later or so. So we wandered around the tulips, tried to stay awake.
we did a good job.
It's pretty amazing.
Yeah, it is pretty amazing. It's not maybe pretty amazing. It's very amazing.
Well,
I know, that's your opinion. Okay, this is mine.
Yeah.
It's amazing.
There's a lot of different tulips, and there were some orchids. I recognized that it wasn't all tulips, all by myself.
Yeah, and there's quite a few flowers that you just won't see in the U.S. It's just a beautiful, beautiful layout and presentation, and very artistically done, and you have some indoor areas where you can go inside and look at some of the flowers, or outside where they've obviously planted them. But it was a great way to stay awake and get another checkbox on your bucket list. You've been to Kukenhof.
That was the building we were in.
I know how important that was to you.
Yeah. The weather was relatively terrible. It was pretty cold.
Relatively. Yeah, it was.
And
it was tolerable.
Drizzly.
And a little bit of sleet now and then, oddly.
Okay, so that was, we saw that, and then we got some food. We got food at the airport. Amsterdam airport is called Schiphol.
Schiphol, right.
Cyndi, how do you pronounce the name of the airport?
Schiphol.
Schiphol.
Yeah, not the way I pronounce it, just looking at the name written out.
Looks like Schiphol, but it's Schiphol.
Yeah. And so we grabbed a sandwich there and stayed at a very cool hotel.
That was probably one of the highlights of the trip, I'm going to have to admit, oddly enough. But there was just so much high tech going on in that room.
So what do you notice about this hallway that's different?
Oh, well, I was going to say the hallway is unusual.
Uh-huh.
It looks more like a prison.
Well, what's interesting is some of the doors open out.
And they had a little iPad that you can control.
You can take that. We're doing a radio show. Would you like to say hello to America?
Hello, America.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning, America.
So, very high-tech hotel called what? Citizen M.
Citizen M. It's right there at the Schiphol Airport, and has these cool little.
We may start lapsing into Dutch, German, and French pronunciations, and maybe even language. We have absorbed a lot of it.
Yeah. But the room was really cool. Like I said, the iPad, you can control the lights, which you had mood lighting, the water closet, if you will, where the toilet
bathroom.
and the shower were, was kind of in this plexiglass, funky-shaped room that you had mood lighting. And so you could make it green, you could make it pink, you could make it purple.
Anything but off.
Yeah, anything but off. It was a little hard to do. And then your iPad controlled your TV. It controlled the shades. We had two types of blinds in the room. One that just kind of, yeah, you could still see a little bit outside. But then the other one was completely blackout because we're right there at the airport. People come in after trips like ours. They want to go to sleep. It's during the day. So they're kind enough to have a full blackout curtain. And
that iPad also controlled the TV. If you turned on the TV, it automatically lowered the blinds.
Be putting the camera away for a little bit here.
And the lighting, yes. So did a little bit of everything. So that was the room itself. But it got us used to little European hotel rooms. And especially it got us in shape for our cabin on the ship.
It was luxurious, actually. It was pretty big.
They were fine. They were absolutely fine. Everything that we needed was there. We weren't going to be spending a lot of time. And in fact, the first night, when we finally went to sleep at about, 5 or 6 o'clock p.m. the day that we arrived.
We wanted to stay up until 7 or so. We couldn't quite make it.
Nope.
So we finished the Tulip Festival. We went back to the hotel by the airport, grabbed a sandwich, ate that, and went up to the room. And we were going to watch a movie or something. And clunk.
Not happening. We slept 14 hours.
Yeah, so that's the thing. You stay up as long as you can, then you sleep as long as you can.
Yeah.
You get up
we
the next
did.
Morning. And
we did, because of that. The next morning we had to find our way downtown.
What did we find?
We found you the perfect suit. Tailor it right here. Rolling.
Folks from Virginia, they speak like American.
Yeah, we had a nice chat.
At least this is a crepe. They call it a pancake here. So here's the syrup stuff.
Sticky stuff.
I tried a little bit of it on here, and I decided I liked it. It was it's mild, it's sweet. I don't know how much
don't
I want.
Put it on mine.
Don't put it. I'll give you a little corner so you
I'll
can
take a little swab of yours. Okay, fine.
And it tastes nothing like maple. It looked caramelish, but it was good.
Next morning, we had to find our way downtown, got a cab down to the boat dock.
272 kilometers.
No, we didn't.
272 kilometers per hour.
Yes, the train is moving. Yes, it's this quiet. No, we can't do this in America.
That's right.
No, we didn't take a cab to downtown. We ended up going on the train because it's only like €5 a piece to get to Central Station in Amsterdam from the airport.
All of these European towns, even a lot of the little ones, have great public transportation. Easy to get around just about every place. Cyndi is trying to do the conversion from 272 kilometers. She should just speak this into Google. It would be easy.
2 miles per hour is... We're not going as fast as we were, so it's not going to be... 169
mile, 170 miles an hour.
Yeah, but it's...
Which is about right.
Yeah.
We did... we also did a high-speed train from...
You're jumping ahead.
I know, but it's relevant.
Okay.
We did the high-speed train from...
Basel,
Switzerland to Paris. And what you hear about these trains is they go 200 miles an hour. But it's like the American advertising up to 200 miles an hour. We saw 200 miles an hour for a few seconds, a few minutes. And then most of the time was between 150 and 175, 180, something like that. So that's about what we're doing now. It doesn't look like it as you look out the window, just like being in an airplane, except that you can see the tracks right next to you and bridges and stuff, and they go whoosh.
As do the trains that come past you.
Yeah, and very smooth and very quiet.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so back to the next day. So we got up the next morning in Amsterdam and took the trains, which are very convenient. They're a big station underneath Schiphol Airport. Takes you down to Central Station, takes about 15 minutes. And then we have to tell them that we were there. That day happened to be King Day, which is...
not Martin Luther.
No, this is the king of the Netherlands. And everybody gets off work. Everybody goes out into the streets, parties their heads off.
It was crowded.
Beer is flowing all over the place, lots of music, dancing in the streets, to the point that they don't even bother to try to bring traffic down some of the streets or some of the rail cars and such, because it's just too full of people. So that was interesting. The weather was a little bit better that day. It rained off and on.
And it is beginning to hail.
But we first checked in down at the... Amma Waterways, which was conveniently right behind Central Station. So.
And I don't think we've told everybody that the body of this trip was a river cruise.
Yes.
Down the Rhein.
Yes.
Through, starting at Amsterdam, through Germany, mostly Germany, mm-hmm. and then touching Switzerland and France on one side for mm-hmm. part of the cruise. So that was the main part, but we'll get to more of that in a minute. So we walked around Amsterdam during this King Day thing. Everybody was wearing orange. Evidently, that's the color.
Mm-hmm.
And did we do anything or just watch it?
No, we just showed you where the red light district was.
I believe this church is the red light district, believe it or not.
You wondered, why did I know how to get there?
Past this point, no cameras.
And
yes, prostitution is legal in one small section of Amsterdam.
We're outside of it. But that is it.
It's not all of it. It's just part of it. There's several blocks either direction.
Why does she know this?
Yeah, and little coffee shops that don't serve coffee. I think we just wandered around because it was still kind of bad weather, and we were kind of tired of the crowds. So we would wander off on some side streets just for fun, look around. But then we had to be back to the ship at 3 p.m. that day to check in and get ourselves situated in the cabin.
Which we did.
Mm-hmm. Lovely. Lovely.
AMA, it's AMA Waterways, is the name of the cruise line. Everyone thinks of Viking. Viking advertises like crazy. AMA does not. This is probably, one step up, two
mm-hmm.
steps up?
Probably, yeah. I would say so.
In both luxury and price.
Yeah.
I don't know. Cyndi paid for this thing. It was an anniversary present to me. I don't want to know. By the way, the day we left Raleigh was our 18th anniversary.
Mm-hmm. Yep. And we spent it separately.
Yes, Cyndi in first class, me in cattle.
As
but only a few
be.
Rows apart.
Yeah.
We've done that before.
Yes.
And what you enjoy is you get sending. Dinner and you have the flight attendant send dessert back to the man.
To the guy in 7A. Yeah.
It was delicious. Better than the one I got with my skimpy little meal. But at least I got a meal.
Yeah.
So we check in to the room. The ship has, what, about 120 people? Passengers?
26. Close to probably 80 rooms, but, you know, they weren't all full on this one, so we only had about 132 passengers, I think is what I heard. So it was very small. I mean, it's wonderful. I like it. We've been on a big cruise ship, and we took our honeymoon cruise in the Caribbean.
Big Royal Caribbean.
Big Royal Caribbean ship. But this one was, you know, only three floors, and I like it better because there are so few people. You kind of get to know people on board. The crew gets to know you.
And they knew us by name.
Yeah, amazingly. Yeah. They would welcome us by name, which...
Mostly speaking German, but the crew is very international from all over the place.
Yes.
And Mr. Pierce, will Mrs. Pierce be joining you for breakfast? No, Mrs. Pierce is sleeping.
Yeah, that's what she does well. But, yeah, I mean, service was just exceptional. The food was out of this world, and it just kept coming day and night. And there was one day where they had early breakfast, late breakfast, then they had this German-Austrian thing. You know, it starts with an F and has lots of letters in it. That they actually, at 10:30 in the morning, they were serving us beer and sandwiches. And then they had lunch an hour later, so it was just continuous.
Just like the Royal food. Caribbean was food all day, all night.
But this
wasn't quite all day, all night, but it was often.
And this was, every meal was just exceptional. They had a fantastic chef. In fact, he won some award, the only cruise line, I think, that's won an award for.
Yeah.
But it was unbelievable.
Now, let me interrupt the flow of the conversation to say this is my first trip to Europe, and there's three things I think I and probably almost everybody on their first trip, something like that, is concerned about in on a trip to a foreign destination. Not necessarily in the order of importance. It is food, language, toilets. And maybe money.
Yes.
Well, the euro has made the money part very easy. So talk about that in a bit. But so the food was an international variety. They tried different countries worth of food and stuff. So it was pretty good.
What do you mean it was pretty good?
It was excellent.
Excuse me?
It was awesome.
Hello!
And I challenged my palate. I ate everything.
And then some.
And
some things many times.
And I didn't run into anything that was just inedible to me. Pretty unusual for me. I'm not a super picky eater, but I'm careful about it.
Uh-huh.
Talk about the places that the trip, the ship went.
Yes, so we did start out in Amsterdam. We were there for 2 days.
Yeah, spent the night in Amsterdam, and then the next morning we could walk around some more. We did some.
Well, we took a little canal cruise.
Oh, that's right, yeah. Okay. And they told us all about it.
But it was raining, and wasn't that pleasant.
Amsterdam is, like Venice, is a city of canals. You have a street, you have a canal. You have a street, you have a canal.
They're everywhere.
And the water's fairly clean because they kind of flush everything out into the ocean. They don't call it the Rhein River at that point, but it's basically the terminus of the Rhein. And a lot of locks along the trip, so they keep the river well controlled. Are you looking at the itinerary so you can remember where we went?
Yeah, so the first destination was Cologne, and that's where we did a walking tour and cathedral visit. We did a lot of cathedral visits. I don't know that I could... The only one that stands out, well, I guess the Sacré-Cœur in Paris and then the Notre-Dame, just because it's so famous. But interestingly, on pretty much every cathedral visit, you have an option to walk up to the top of the tower. And we took advantage of that. And some of these...
Not necessarily for free.
No, they weren't for free, but they were well worth it because of the view that you could get overlooking the city. But man, well, that's where it was good because we had to work off those calories we were eating on the ship. And when you climb up the equivalent of a 21-story building, you work off a few calories.
A few.
A few. So Cologne was a walking tour. We then went down to Rüdesheim. Do you remember anything else at Cologne?
I don't remember all of it at the moment until I go look at my 15 hours of video. All of it is kind of a blur.
Mm-hmm.
The ship travels down the river at about 7 or 8 miles an hour. The current is about 5 miles an hour on average, hitting the opposite direction. So the ship doesn't go real fast. In fact, if you're up on the deck, they have a circle track on the top deck, and you can walk briskly at about the pace of the ship.
Yeah.
And for a couple hundred yards or a couple hundred feet, you can walk so that the shoreline is standing still.
Yeah, that was pretty.
You can't keep it up too long or you'll walk off the end of the ship. But
speaking of the shoreline, the neat thing that they do on the Rhein is they have kilometer markers the whole way, so you know exactly where you are. So you'd see like 263, then you'll see 0.9, 0.8, 0.7, 0.6, point plus, instead of a 0.5, it says plus, and then 0.4, 3, 2, and 1, and then big mile kilometer.
We are going 334.7 kilometers per hour.
Oh, okay, hold on. 334.7, okay. 334.7.
Doing the calculation. This is going to be closer to 200 miles an hour. I would expect international listeners are going, we know what it is, don't waste our time. And we're going through the French countryside. It is, by the way, today, a beautiful sunny day. It's going to be in the about 70 or so. The weather got better as we went along.
Yeah, 208.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
We're going 200. Listen to the background.
Yeah, quiet.
Just a little whoosh.
Yeah, a little whoosh.
208 miles an hour. So I'm not sure I could do justice to talking about what was in each town, but as you go down the Rhein, on the first day, it's a lot of industrial, a lot of just ordinary, what you'd see. Well, a lot of rural and agricultural, and then some
flat.
Industrial.
It's
very flat. And then the second day, you get into what I'm going to call Disneyland.
Yeah, Koblenz is where we arrived that morning, and we did a tour there. And then I think we're. Does that make sense? We were back on the boat. Oh, Koblenz, we did the nighttime tour. That's right, because we started out in Cologne that morning, got to Koblenz sometime in the late afternoon, and we took a nighttime tour. And then the next morning, well, sometime in the night, they started out again. And that was the Disneyland day where we were headed toward Rüdesheim.
Yeah, the travel schedule is not all traveling at night because there's a lot of things you want to see during the day along the shore of the river. So sometimes it's traveling at night, sometimes it's traveling during the day. So the coolest part of the trip is the day that you go down what they call the Rhein Valley.
Mm-hmm.
The landscape is no longer flat.
No,
it's not mountainous. It's ancient mountains that are you know just kind of rounded and you know, big hills.
Mm-hmm.
And it's mostly rural. But every
towns.
Couple of kilometers, every mile or so, a couple of miles, there's this little town. Little gingerbread town.
Mm-hmm.
That is,
no modern buildings.
Yeah, purely out of Sound of Music.
Mm-hmm.
And
cathedrals
these,
and castles.
Yeah, and the castles, some of them are ruins, some of them have been restored, some of them are somewhere in between.
And quite a few have been turned into hotels and hostels.
Yeah.
What we heard.
But they're really cool to look at. And most of them are overlooking the river on a bluff above or near one of these little towns. And I guess I didn't go for all the history we would have been totally overloaded and overwhelmed. And even if we'd heard people telling us the history, I wouldn't remember it. In fact, there was this little audio device.
The Quiet Box.
The Quiet Box. It's a little, what it reminded me of is an electric soldering iron.
It does. It looked like a little small soldering iron, yeah.
Yep. Yeah, it hangs on a lanyard around your neck, and you plug earphones into it. And on the ship, every 10 minutes or so, or whenever you go by something, it comes on and gives you a little description of what it is you're passing. Although it seemed a lot of the time to be out of sync with where we were. Sometimes it was describing something I could see, and sometimes it's describing something, and I'm looking around, and I can't see it. When you were in town on a walking tour, then the guide has a transmitter, and the 5, 10, 15, 20 people that are on the tour are listening to this, and they can hear the guide without... Cyndi just discovered her seat would slide back. There's a little video that's constantly going over.
About how to use all the things here on the train, and I just discovered that I could kind of...
Slide back
a little bit.
Where's that button?
It's right on that. It's your little... Well, I don't know. You might not have one because you're
I'm sure I do. I want to slide back. We can't figure it out.
Okay.
So...
sorry.
So the guide would talk into theirs, and so you wouldn't have to be standing right next to the guide. The guide wouldn't have to shout. The only problem was... It didn't always work.
And there was one particular tour.
It was digital, though. It was digital.
Yes,
It must be high-tech and really good.
And the other thing that's good about it is because you don't have to stay right beside your guide, you can always hear what they're saying, is you can fall back, like I like to, and go get another shot of something, you know, at a better angle than where you were originally standing, and then catch up with the group.
Don't go around a corner.
Don't go around the corner, because we were in, I guess it was Koblenz, that evening tour, when our guide went off around the corner and he just disappeared. I was kind of disappointed in the system. I thought I could do better, but...
Yeah. Of course, I looked it up. It's 900 megahertz, spread spectrum digital. And part of the problem is that the guides unit and the receivers from the tourists, us passengers, didn't always synchronize. So on one tour, there were probably about 10 people, and maybe 5 of them hooked up, and 5 of them didn't.
Yeah.
So we just kind of... So there was a couple of us that were, you know, technology forward, and we're trying to troubleshoot and fix things, and well, everybody else is in the bathroom, and we have them change channels, and by the time we had totally bollocks things up, nobody could hear him. So he just had to do things the old-fashioned way and just holler to us as we were walking around the town. Mm-hmm. In some of the bigger towns had shopping areas they took us to, and I think that they put us mostly in the tourist zone.
So, interesting, this transitions into a business district area out of a very concentrated shopping area, sort of their version of a mall, I guess.
Yeah. Yes.
We didn't get out of the tourist zone, the tourist bubble.
Well, we didn't have time in a lot of these places. We had to stick close by to our schedule.
But what impressed me was that instead of shopping malls, they just had outdoor streets, just downtown streets. Some of them closed to vehicle traffic, some of them not. And for block after block after block, there were stores kind of the way you'd find in a big American mall.
Mm-hmm. Except they were all open. Well, they were all full.
Yeah. None of them were closed.
Right. The fact that it was evening.
It's a Pizza Hut.
None of them were out of business. Everybody was in business.
Mm-hmm.
We're in a tunnel. We're not in the tunnel.
No.
We're heading for the channel tunnel.
Yeah, the channel.
I don't think we're in the channel.
So, language difficulty. You thought it was strawberry?
Well, it had a picture of strawberry.
Oh. But
the
it's
name
not.
Was... Erd beer.
But it's good.
E-R-D-B-E-E-R-E.
But it's good.
Oh. Oh, yeah.
Better than strawberry.
Uh-huh.
I'm not sure why we'd be in a tunnel, though, because this is flat. There's no hills.
It's...
And we're back out.
Sort of, yeah. Well, I think we're getting towards Calais.
After getting lost and walking in a circle at least once and probably twice, we relied on Google, which didn't really work all that well for walking because it kept switching what direction we were going, but eventually we got back.
Yeah. Do we have stops before we...
No, this is straight
through.
Stop
to London.
Yeah. So we'll see in a minute if we come out of it. If not, we're in the channel already, which would be surprising because we've got another hour already.
No, we don't. Remember the time change.
Yes.
It's 2:06.
Oh, we're supposed to be there at 2. Well, maybe we're in the channel. How about that? We missed
I think we're in the channel.
Nope.
Well, we've popped out. I don't know which side we're on.
No, it's still French.
It's still French?
Still French. So this is probably Calais. It's my guess. But anyway, we'll try to watch for the channel.
So in a few towns, they were like this. And I get into the zone where I think, well, this is the way things are. And then you move on and you're in a typical industrial area and you say, oh, yeah, here's the real world.
Mm-hmm.
So is there anything else that stood out to you along the...
Our Heidelberg visit when we actually had a private tour.
Next trip to Heidelberg on the bus.
Now, I have to explain the reason why we were on a private tour.
Well, yes.
We were approximately the youngest people on this ship. I'm 66, Cyndi is 57, and almost everybody else could be our parents, another generation up. So they would offer these tours in active, gentle, wheel you around in a wheelchair. And we always took the active tours, bicycle or walking, and there was one other couple or no other couples. So this was the active tour in Heidelberg.
So hello everybody and welcome to Heidelberg. My name is Christina. Let's have a look.
So we got a tour guide to ourselves, and instead of taking the historical tour, we talked about current events, America, Germany.
Trump.
Donald Trump.
Yeah.
And learned a lot about the way things really are over mm-hmm. there and people think. And
privacy laws.
Yeah. Talked about a lot of stuff.
Yeah, it was great. And plus it was just
a lovely...
Well,
we were walking through the woods.
Yeah, beautiful forest, perfect weather, beautiful views back towards the castle there in Heidelberg.
Yeah, we finally left the cold and wet behind us. It wasn't.
Yes.
It was still
mm-hmm.
cool, but it was not raining.
Fantastic. And then we hit another couple of small towns, Breisa and Freiburg.
It occurs to me, when we're in Hawaii, we always kind of make fun of the people on the buses.
Yeah, now we're the ones being made fun of.
We are going to France.
And the pink group, we will make
here comes France.
Storks, also with
stork
baby storks.
On top of the tree.
Can you imagine, with the baby storks, we have more than 200 storks.
Freiburg, I don't think you're pronouncing the Breisa right.
I think I am.
Maybe you are.
Yeah, it's one of those words that you look at and you go, that just doesn't look like it sound like that. That's what they would say. So, yeah, more walking tours we had. We were supposed to do a bike tour that last day, but it was raining. So we ended up down in Freiburg and Breisa.
So is it real or is it Disneyland? Well, most of the buildings were destroyed in World War II and have been rebuilt since. But they built it in old style, but it's all been built since the 40s, 50s, and 60s.
One thing we've realized about doing the trip this way is you pass a lot just floating down the river. You make an occasional stop, get the flavor of the tourist version of the area, and then back on the river. You could do it much more slowly on a train, in a car, motorcycle, even bicycle, and absorb the flavor if you've got the time to spend. So if you wanted to concentrate just on the Rhine Valley or just a few towns and spend your week, you could do that. But the ship was an interesting way to...
Introduction.
Yeah, good introduction. About the right speed to get through a lot, still see some. Then the ship's terminus, the finish of the ship, part of the voyage, was in Basel, Switzerland, which is right on the border. It's France, Germany, and Switzerland all come together at that point.
Bye-bye. Merci. Au revoir.
Throughout this trip, we were spending euros. Switzerland has Swiss francs. So, a little, but they would take euros. But I bought, I don't know, lunch or a snack or something, and paid in euros, but got change in Swiss coins. Not a whole franc, but, you know, a couple of coins. And then the next part of the trip was the high-speed train from Basel to Paris.
700 miles an hour to Paris.
It peaks out at 205 miles an hour or so and doesn't spend very much time going that speed.
It stays around 150 or so.
Yeah, that's pretty, still pretty amazing.
95 is the slowest.
Yeah. This train is a little plusher, but that was still pretty nice.
Oh, yes.
And quiet like this. Mm-hmm. You know, just kind of gentle rocking. If you're walking down the aisle, you want to hold on, because it'll take a little bump now and then. But very, very nice.
Yes.
And then we got to Paris.
Mm-hmm. Yep. Our friend Rodney met us at the train station.
Bonjour, Rodney.
Bonjour.
Comment allez-vous?
And we were whisked away by a cab to our hotel. And then we took off for dinner that night. Rodney, of course, has been living as an expat in Paris for many years. I knew him when I worked at ITT way, way, way back when, after I graduated from college, first job. And he, unfortunately, had had some health issues recently and could not go out with us on our tours, but at least told us what we should see, how we should see it, what stations, what metro stops and things like that. So it was very handy. And then he would meet us for dinner every night. He would come by the hotel. We'd get on the metro or the bus and head to always a very, very nice restaurant. He's obviously spent a lot of time there and knows all the good places. So we were continuing to be fed like little foie gras ducks, just stuffing it down our gullet.
So we were sort of out of the tourist zone. One thing about the ship is that everything is English. The guides all speak good English.
It is Thursday, May 5th.
We can
rent a bike.
Yeah.
And where's the first place an American tourist must go the very first time in London?
In London. We're in Paris.
In Paris. Edit in Paris.
Edit in Paris. We must go to the Eiffel Tower or Tour Eiffel.
And you're being catered to and made comfortable by not being out in the middle of scary foreign territory. And I was talking about the things that worry about in taking an international trip, which would be language, so they took care of that. And food didn't turn out to be such a big problem. And toilets, we haven't talked about toilets. Well, they're pretty American these days. Didn't run into anything specifically unusual.
Or just holes in the floor.
Yeah, probably the only even close to unusual thing is that the many of the toilets have two buttons to flush. A little one and a big one.
We'll just let you all figure out what that means.
So we went in Paris, even though we were outside the tourist bubble. We were only there for two full days, plus a little bit in the evening when we got there, and not really much this morning. We slept in.
Yes, we needed to. We've been doing an awful lot of walking, like 7-8 miles a day, plus all the stair climbing and the cathedrals and the Arc de Triomphe was another one we got to go up on the top of.
So this being our first trip, we did the tourist stuff. We didn't try to go look beyond the tourist destination. So we went up to the top of the Eiffel Tower.
All the way to the top.
Yeah. Got lost trying to get out.
Yeah, we swore there was no way down.
We finally found our way out. We did a lot of walking, but we also used the Paris Metro, and it is very impressive.
Oh my goodness, yes. And the thing is it's unlike our metro systems back in the U.S. because they're trains constantly. mean, the minute one leaves the station, you can almost see another one coming down the track.
During the day, 4 minutes, 5 minutes maximum between trains.
At the most. I don't remember waiting that long for any of them.
Often a minute. Sometimes very, very crowded.
Two things, yeah, sometimes in certain areas. But the two things that were kind of interesting is, one, they don't, because they're older, they don't have a lot of elevators where you'd think they should. And also,
I can't believe how much effort it was to dig these things out. We walked up from one train, and we swear we walked 400 feet up.
Yeah, it was. I'd love to see a 3D mapping of some of these stations, because we would walk up and down and up and down in long hauls. And this is just in a single station. And
because sometimes two or three train lines have to cross each other underground.
Yeah, but it's unlike, you know, the ones that I'm familiar with, more like the Metro in D.C. and Atlanta. You know, those stations, you can see the layers because they just, you know, they one right above the other. But here, I guess it was afterthoughts for some of these things. Maybe they had to dig deeper to get some new lines in, but it was just amazing, the up and down and all over the place.
This guy just saw how long the line is.
Spending money, spending euros is easy. The euro is currently about $1.14 American, so...
$1.20.
No, but if it's $1.20, the dollar went up today, because it's been $1.14 or so all past 2 weeks. In any case, you're pretty much spending money like you would at home. In Switzerland, I said the Swiss were still using francs, and when we go to the UK, which is what we're on our way to now, it'll be back to British pounds. So, and they're talking about, do we want to get out of the European Union? Let's talk about European Union just a little bit, and then we'll wrap things up. Because we traveled through, starting with Netherlands, into France, into Switzerland, back into France.
Sure.
How many times did we show our passport?
Zero.
Yeah, once in Philadelphia to get on the plane.
Mm-hmm. That was it.
Because they don't want you to end up in Amsterdam.
And the next time was actually a little while ago.
But we went through some customs in Amsterdam. I think we probably showed our passport there.
Oh, sure.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But then, and we showed it to the folks on the ship.
Well, yeah,
like they took it for a night.
It's like the hotel did last night. They do that.
And
it's standard procedure.
Okay. And then traveling across those borders is nothing.
Nope.
For us or for anyone. Getting on the train here, we did have to go through passport control. Show us your papers, please. Which I think, you know, Britain is...
trying to get out of the European Union, it shows.
I mean, they've had this love-hate relationship with the concept of being European. I don't think they call themselves Europe. I don't know. You guys can tell me. But it seemed like... I can't believe the effort that it must have gone into getting all of these disparate countries, everyone who for a long, long time had been very nationalistic, to create what's a sort of a European version of the U.S., where the countries become more like states in terms of commerce, travel, currency.
Mm-hmm.
Pretty impressive that they were able to do that and are working on holding it together, because it's pretty new and not everybody's excited about the idea. And nationalism still tends to run high. Part of the reason that they got it done, Cindy's looking around at the trying to figure out Cindy's lost complete interest in the program now. And
that happens a lot.
You never watch the show, do you?
I listen to you record them all over and over again. I've heard them all, trust me.
Okay. So I think a big part of the reason, and our guide was explaining to us, a big part of the reason why they did this was they get tired of war. Fighting each other whenever they had a difference. So they have not just the European Union, but there's a couple of other layers of bureaucracy that help them figure out solutions to problems across borders without taking up arms and fighting each other. And they're all the people we talked to, a small sample, I'm sure, absolutely terrified of the idea of Donald Trump being president.
Yes. Completely terrified.
And not quite understanding what it's all about. So That we're on our way to London. Let me talk about ham radio for just a little bit. I did bring a hand. Cindy's walking. No, I brought a handy talkie. I brought my ICOM 92AD,
but
I forgot a charger. So I've got a couple of batteries. I haven't used it up. I did use a couple of the apps, R-Finder and one other that I don't remember the name of, a free app, and looked up in a couple of places in Germany, in Basel and in Paris, repeaters, plugged them in, nothing. No, couldn't find a D-Star repeater, couldn't find analog repeaters, couldn't key up anything. And I don't know if I was doing something wrong. They have odd offsets. They only got 2 megahertz of the 2-meter band and a smaller portion of the 70-centimeter band, and they don't do the standard offsets that we do much. I think on 2 meters they were still doing 600 kilohertz. On 70 centimeters they were 9.5 megahertz, some very different offsets. I'm able to plug this in correctly. I think I got everything in right, but didn't hear anything. Didn't do a lot of scanning. Very little. Here's where you can come back in on the conversation. There wasn't any time for hamming.
No.
We were busy. I may give it a try in London. One of the advantages in London is, of course, we'll be speaking English. So if I get on the air, I wanted to find someone who can speak English. I might give that another try, but this has not been much of a ham radio trip. And there was no time for arranging visits. I know a really great and traditional and honorable thing in ham radio is that hams traveling internationally get to meet other hams, and they're treated like royalty, and everything is wonderful. And it would have been great to meet some hams in some of these places. But this trip is too fast, going from one place to another much too quickly. So we didn't have time. The next trip to Europe, plan a little bit more time, a little more leisure.
This is our neighborhood convenience store.
I know there's a lot of you guys out there around the world that enjoy ham radio now, and many of you would have loved to see me. Now, this is one of those things. Be careful about meeting your heroes, because you're going to be disappointed.
Yeah, let me tell you.
Yeah, Cindy knows me in person. I'm not that exciting. I'm not an exciting person. I play one on TV.
The original party vegetable.
Yeah. Not great in party and company. So, well. Next trip, we'll try to do some of that ham radio stuff. Any of you guys coming to Dayton, look me up. I'll be the guy running around crazily with the cameras and stuff. So let's wrap this episode up. Always mention at the end that Ham Radio Now, again, brought to you by you. So stop by Arvin, Le Pig.
Forget the name for the pig.
Yeah, can't remember French for pig. HamRadioNow.tv if you enjoy either the ham or the non-ham versions of the Ham Radio Now programs, the video or this first ever and maybe last ever pure audio version. I'll do a little video thing just to get it on YouTube to say go listen to the audio. And we get back, plenty of things to do. Probably squeeze in a couple more shows before Dayton and then off to Dayton. I think I'll be recording forums and stuff, and I'll do the walk around looking for the manufacturers, the guys who make the little gigaws and doodads that don't get a lot of everybody else's attention. And we'll have fun. So that's it. I am Gary Pierce, KN4AQ.
And I am Cindy Pierce, KD4ACW.
Over.
And out.